And now we move on to the next segment of the bulletin on the table. Over to you, Mohana.
Good evening. The issue of mental health and the use of social media has been greatly debated over the past few weeks in the country. Now, to help us get a science-based perspective, we have Professor Dr. Andrew Mohanraj, the president of the Malaysian Mental Health Association and the director of the Impact Lab on Mental Health and Wellbeing at Taylor's University. Welcome, Prof.
Thank you, Mohana.
Prof, let's get straight into what studies are showing on the use of social media and mental health. What's the link?
Well, if you look at it globally, out of the 7.7 billion people, about 3.5 billion people are online. And out of this, one out of three individuals are on social media.
Right.
And this group is largely populated by adolescents and young adults.
Yeah.
So this means that adolescents and young adults are venturing into what can be known as an unsafe space with its own implications. So there are studies, several studies overseas showing that this problem is alarming. Mm-hmm. However, in Malaysia,
yes.
I was quite fascinated by a study by the MCMC in the year 2019, which showed that 89% of their respondents were addicted to the internet. And by extension, it means that it is addiction to social media as well. There are several other studies also indicating very alarming rates of addiction to social media in Malaysia. But looking at all these studies, I can safely say that at least 60% of social media users in Malaysia have some forms of addiction to social media.
Just very quickly, Prof, what causes this addiction?
Yeah, addiction, by definition, obviously means that there is some sort of psychological condition attached to it, as well as probably physical conditions itself. But addiction, or rather social media, operates in the space of validation and getting likes on social media. So that, of course, plays a role in the reward pathway in the brain, releasing dopamine in the reward pathway, brings some form of satisfaction.
Right.
And increased stimulus in this pathway causes addiction.
Mm-hmm.
And as I mentioned, addiction also means that there is some form of impairment involved. And usually this impairment is seen in the social and occupational domain of an individual.
Right. Now, we do know that you've mentioned about social media addiction being very real. Should there be parental control for young people then? Should we be controlling how many hours somebody is on social media or at least supervision?
I think parents play a very important role here. But before we discuss parental controls per se, I think it is important for parents to be close to their children, bonding with their children, discussing the challenges that their child and children face in school and universities is important, because children who are victims of social, of bullying, cyberbullying, may not open up to their parents for a variety of reasons.
Okay.
So it is important to be close to your child to discuss social media issues. So that's the first thing that should happen.
Sure.
Then, of course, there should be parental controls as well. I mean, it is good to understand or to know what are the to impose some form of limitation on the use of social media, to know the password of your child's account and things like that. But also to educate the child on how to handle a situation where the child is a bully, a victim of bullying on social media, how not to respond to the bully, how to document that particular post, like taking a snapshot of that with the date and the content very clear. And parents also should understand the mechanisms of complaining about of this situation.
So filing an official
report, and basically to instill on the child some form of responsible, you know, digital citizenship. Right. I think that is ultimately the role of the parents, rather than the parents, you know, sort of passing the buck to schools to do this. Yeah. But ultimately, parents must also lead by example. We have a scenario in which, you know, we have generations like the generation Y and Z, where the age gap is sort of like, it's in the state where the parents themselves would have been introduced to social media at a very young age. Yeah. And therefore, it is unfair to expect the child to exercise discipline when the parents themselves are not so disciplined in this.
Now, Prof, you mentioned cyberbullying. I'm curious, what causes a person to cyberbully or to bully? I mean, we've heard of bullying which happens in person. Is there a difference between cyberbullying and bullying in person?
Yes,
what causes
cyberbullying becomes far more dangerous because of that perceived anonymity here.
Right.
And because of that, people it makes people a little bit more braver and makes them more bold to bully. But what actually makes a bully? You know, I mean, this is a question of power dynamics here, where the bully feels this is more powerful to decimate or destroy the bully on social media. There could be people, bullies, who have been bullied before as well, who themselves have had issues with self-esteem.
Right.
But on the other hand, there are also bullies who actually have personality issues, like explosive personality traits, narcissistic personality traits, and also those with serious mental health conditions like bipolar disorder, or depression or schizophrenia. And likewise, the victims also could be those with susceptible personalities and also have a diagnosis like bipolar disorder or depressive symptoms or a depressive disorder. And it is this category that would be more likely, more vulnerable and could even succumb to self-harm and even, you know, suicide attempts.
Mm-hmm. Should we then look at increasing the mental resilience of young people who are starting to go onto social media?
Yes, I think that's really crucial here, to educate young people on how to use social media in a responsible manner.
Yeah.
But I think prior to that, it's also important for all of us, including young people, to ask ourselves, you know, to have a bit of self-reflection here and ask ourselves, why are we using social media in the first place?
Right.
I think initially it was started where people thought social media will be good to connect with friends.
Connection,
social connection, which is good for mental health, right?
Correct.
And also to develop potential friendships. Mm-hmm. Then as add-ons, people started using it for advertisements, for business, for promotions, for campaigns and all that. So these add-ons are the ones that actually brought in the more dangerous aspects of social media.
Right.
So to give you a straight answer, I could tell you that you could just switch off, you could just withdraw from social media and still manage life. But that's not the appropriate answer here, simply because I've given you statistics to show how more than half the world's population is online and one-third of people are on social media. So you cannot wish this problem away.
That's right.
And therefore, it is important to focus on resilience. If we have already been victims of social media or being victims of cyberbullying, then I think it's important to focus on counseling services, peer group support. These are things that we need to improve on in our country. Besides just the focusing on the punitive actions.
Okay. Now we've got a couple of minutes left, Prof. What message do you have for adults, young people, teenagers, adolescents, with regards to safeguarding their mental health in this digital age?
The digital platforms, as I said, is quite widespread. And therefore, my message would be to be careful with the words that we use mm-hmm. on social media, because words are powerful.
That's right.
And words can destroy another individual, as we have seen in the case that was widely reported recently. Mm-hmm. Even if you cannot help and support another individual online, mm-hmm. but just remember that it is better to stay away from trying to be destructive on online interactions, even if you cannot support mm-hmm. another individual. And the fact that there is a perception that there is a high level of anonymity yeah. on social media. Now, that perception might have to change soon, with the government being very serious about framing the appropriate legislation to address cyberbullying.
Prof. Andrew, thank you so much for your
thank
time
you.
Today. That's all the time we've got for you today. Thank you so much for your insights.
Thank you very much.
We've been speaking to Professor Dato' Dr. Andrew Mohan Raj, President of the Malaysian Mental Health Association and Director of the Impact Lab on Mental Health and Wellbeing at Taylor's University. It's now back to you.